Chapter 4, Section 3, Protein Tertiary and Quaternary Structures. Tertiary quaternary structures are levels of complexity above what we've discussed so far. Primary, first level, the amino acid strand. Secondary, do sections of that amino acid string form the alpha helix, beta strand, beta turn, or something ambiguous? Tertiary here, well, what's the overall arrangement of those alpha helices, beta strands? Do they form beta sheets? How many beta sheets? Is it a flat beta sheet? Is it more of a, curvature to it? Blah, 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 blah. And then the quaternary is, well, how many polypeptides do you have to get together to have a complete protein that's going to have the correct shape, conformation, correct shape to have a function? We see that proteins fall under four generalized groups: fibrous, globular, membrane, and disordered. We're going to focus first on fibrous, move into globular, and I think we're going to leave membrane to a later chapter, because membrane have their own thing going on, because there are extremely hydrophobic, and I told you you can't have things, that are hydrophobic in solution. Well, it turns out they're not in solution. They're embedded in one of the most hydrophobic places in the cell, a membrane. And we'll talk more about those in a little bit. First, we're going to discuss these fibrous proteins. Okay, we are fibrous proteins, as their name infers. They're fibrous. They're fibers of proteins. They're not that globular thing. It looks like your fist or a wadded up piece of paper. These are going to be long strands of proteins that have secondary structure and that are going to be interwoven with other same shaped polypeptides. They are very insoluble in water. Okay. Because of how many hydrophobic residues. And these aren't enzymes. These aren't things you want interacting with all of the other components of the cell, because they're going to have their own job. They're going to have their own thing that they're responsible for. And they're not always going to be in an aqueous environment in our bodies. I mean, you look, keratin, you go to table 4.2 in the textbook online, in the ebook, you'll see that some of these fibrous proteins that you've probably heard of, alpha keratin. Okay, keratin's what fills up the cells that become our hair strands. They're also what make up feathers, nails. Certain collagens, going to be tendons, part of the bone matrix, are going to be these types of fibrous proteins, and we don't want them in solution. We don't worry about them interacting with other cellular proteins and things. No. So we're not going to worry about how soluble there are. We're not going to worry about keeping about those hydrophobic residues, those hydrophobic amino acids, to the center. Because honestly, as we're going to see here, there is no center. You take, for an example, alpha keratin. One polypeptide is a continuous right-hand twist that coils with another right-handed twist polypeptide, except here they're doing a left-hand twist. It's one of these weird things that sailors and rope makers have known for hundreds and hundreds of years. And if you go and you look at rope, or you go look at yarn or string or any of that, it's not just one big cable of something. It's thousands of little ones that are wrapped around each other. A couple of them wrap around each other, form a bundle. Take some more of those same type of bundles, wrap them around each other, and you get thicker and thicker as you keep wrapping. Well, the thing they figured out hundreds of years ago is if you wrap everything the same way with the right twist, and you wrap those right, they unravel too easily. But if you take, as you see here, a singular polypeptide that has a right-hand twist, another one with a right-hand twist, but you wrap them around each other, in a left twist, it doesn't unravel that easily. Something about those countering twists as you move up in structure actually hold the lower level structures in check. So you take this little bit, you see here, these two polypeptides, they're not very long, there's not much going on, but you lay them parallel. So you can see here, here's the twist, the two twisted together, here's another one, here's a third, and there's a part of a fourth. You lay them by each other, and you allow hydrogen bonds and other non-covalent bonds to hold them associated together, and you just start laying them down, the two by each other, and then take that set, lay it side by side with another like this. You get a protofilament. You take a bunch of the protofilaments, lay them side by side. You get a protofibril. Now notice how none of the ends line up. Go look at a brick building. They never line all the edges up because that instills weakness at all the joints. But by offsetting here and changing the orientation of things, yeah, this instills even more stability. And you start building it up. You take the protofibrils, you start wrapping them around the protofilaments, protofilaments wrap around protofibrils, take the protofibrils, wrap them around, get intermediates, and then these intermediate filaments wrap around each other, and this is what fills in, you know, each of these irregular shaped things you see here is in a cell. You fill up the cell with these. Because remember, the cells of your nails, your hair, they're dead. They are metabolically dead. All intracellular contents have been removed and replaced with keratin fibers, fibrous keratin. What we find when we look across all the animals, you know, that use, you know, alpha keratin, alanine, valine, leucine, isoleucine, methionine, phenylalanine. These are what's are the predominant amino acids. Now, as you get up in levels of complexity, we'll start to see that disulfide bonds start holding things together. So it's not just, you know, our non-covalent bonds holding things, you know, the hydrogen bonds and stuff like that. More you get there, the more you need to stabilize, you start to see a covalent bond here. Not a carbon-carbon covalent bond. It's a sulfur-sulfur. Sulfur is coming in the R groups. Another fibrous one we're going to see here is collagen. Collagen also does that same thing we saw before. We talked about with fibrin. The keratin, sorry. Right-hand twist. I'm sorry, a left-hand helix, but a right-hand twist when you take the three collagen strands and wrap them around each other. Counter twist, you know, aid in stability. This counter twist also allows for the lining up, as we see here, of the R groups. So the R groups, hydrogen bond, ionic, some disulfide bonds going on, so that it is now nice and stable. When we look at and compare collagen amongst us animals, those of us who use collagen, we see that there is a repeated structure at the amino acid level. Glycine, X, Y. X, Y are just variables. More often than not, as an X, you're going to see proline. More often than not, you're going to see for hype, and I forget, sorry, what the hype stands for. It's a altered version of one of the amino acids that I'm drawing a complete blank on right this moment. So X can be multiple things, but if you're a betting person, it's proline. Y could be many things, but more often than not, for hype. So left-handed alpha helixes that are twisted around each other in a right-hand twist. And again, you see these lining up and they are bonded, cross-linked to each other. This structure right there, that's the three left-handed in a right-hand twist. You line them up, offset, disulfide bonds across to hold everything together. Also, you're going to see that some of the cross-linking is not going to be disulfide bonds, as I said on the press last one. It's going to be this weird red double bond between two neighboring residues. Residues that are on neighboring because of where they're at in orientation-wise, but they're on different alpha helices. Lysine residue and a modified lysine residue or histidine residue. The R groups are going to be pointed in towards each other, the correct orientation, and then an enzyme is going to put in that double bond there. Double bond there, definitely way stronger than the disulfide bond, which is way, way, way stronger than any hydrogen bond, ionic interaction, and whatnot. It's interesting. The book goes into this, and I thought I'd just touch on it because it's really, really, really cool. Oh, that hydroxyproline, that's what that was before. I do believe the hype, before hype. Scurvy, lack of vitamin C. Lack of vitamin C used to cause the disease called scurvy, which was an ailment that many, many, many sailors, back when they actually were sailing, you know, wind sails, that they would suffer from. And it wasn't until someone figured out, and I can't remember who off the top of my head, that it's a lack of fresh fruit and vegetables. So they used to stock up. Fast forward 100 years or so later, a century or so later, they figured out that it's not the vegetables or fruit per se, it's actually a component in one of them, you know, in them, vitamin C. So, you know, not going to go into the whole sailor things, how they used to go and, you know, here's your lemon wedge or things like that. Hopefully those will keep it away. You're not going to worry about that. The whole point of this was the vitamin C is responsible for the making of the hydroxyproline, this hydroxylation, the changing of the bonds, adding this hydroxyl there and altering some of the bonds within, because you need those so you can get a stable collagen fiber forming. Without stable collagen, things start to fall apart, because collagen, remember, is what wraps around clusters of cells so they can now be looked at as tissues. It takes the tissues wrapped around them. That's what you get to, you know, form part of what helps you form the organs and keep the organs together. No vitamin C, no replacement for hydroxyproline for the upkeep of collagen, which you're breaking down, damaging on a daily basis. Things start to fall apart. And so far we've been talking about these filamentous ones, and I keep referring to alpha helices. Alpha helices aren't the only secondary structure that's going to be there seen in fibrous polypeptides and their, you know, tertiary and quaternary structure. Turns out the beta strands can also. Here you see here fibroin, which is a main protein in silk. They form, the beta strands form these anti-parallel beta sheets. The anti-parallel beta sheets, rich in alanine, rich in glycine, stabilized, crossed by hydrogen bonds, van der Waals interactions, and whatnot. When we look at globular proteins, instead of being a nice strand, literally, you know, they're going to be this mass, you know, this mass, this, well, glob. You know, I keep, you know, in my head, and I'll say it every so often in lecture, that when you think of these globular proteins, think of a wadded up piece of wet paper, because that's the overall, you know, what they look like. They're not the nice, you know, alpha helix. I know it's hard for you guys to see here, you know, like this twisted up paper. It's more of that kind of focus, that kind of wadded up thing. Some biochemist and cell biologist and whatnot were trying to figure out why globular proteins are there. Why that distinct shape? You know, what is it about them that gives stability? What is it about them that, you know, we see quite a few of them? Well, what they found is, you know, you take the alpha helices, the beta strands and all that, the beta sheets, and you start folding it back in on itself, and it becomes much, much more compact than anything you can see in a fibrous protein. Well, compacted proteins that have a structure and have a function, I can see that would help. They took in amino acids and, you know, they tweaked the phi psi angles, and what they came up with was the beta conformation. And they noticed that it gave a polypeptide, you know, tertiary structure that was quite long. Turned it an alpha helix. You know, did the same thing in the computer with, you know, phi psi angles, made them all alpha helices. Still quite large. But if they allowed it to go through to its native form, the same amino acid that would give us this long beta strand or this long alpha helix would give us a much smaller, more compact globular form. Book points out, and I put a nice big star here for the protein data bank. If we're going to be discussing anything proteins in a couple weeks, we're going to be talking about a research paper you're going to have to do. This protein data bank, you know, pretty much most proteins that have been studied, X-ray crystallography, or they have, you know, sequence have been published, anything like that, you're going to find in this database. We'll talk more about that at a later date. Just brought it up because it's mentioned in the textbook. But you take that globular protein. You see here in the A, figure A, showing you the ribbon structure, the alpha helices. Really no beta strands here. And you have, you know, this, within it, this structure there, a pocket, you know, a binding pocket where some form of a substrate or something that that globular protein is going to interact with, where it will, you know, the amino acid residues are such that that's where they will interact. Here in C and D, same structures, but this time they told the computer to highlight, and that's what you see yellow, highlight any residue that has an R group, any amino acid that has an R group that is hydrophobic. In C, you see a lot of yellow. Okay, so there's a lot of hydrophobic residues there, hydrophobic R groups. But when you look at the space filling model here in D, which is pretty much the same as what you see here in B, just instead of smoothed out like they did here, they left it a little more, or, you know, roughed. Well, all the yellows you see here, majority of them are covered up. The majority of them are going to be at the center of this globular protein, extruding the water out, helping to maintain a very non-aqueous environment at the center of this globular protein. Non-aqueous environment in an aqueous solution means this is going to help maintain the overall tertiary quaternary structure of this polypeptide. Yes, some of those hydrophobic R groups are showing through, some, but not a lot of them, because remember we were talking about that solvent shell, that solvent layer, that hydration shell, that hydration layer. As long as enough of those residues will interact with water, you can force this into solution. The globular proteins have an overall shape or have a distinct pattern of alpha helices and beta strands or beta sheets. And it depends on which one you're talking about. If you go and look at the chymotrypsins, all the animals use chymotrypsins or cytochrome C. Cytochrome C, lots of alpha helices, no beta strands. Myoglobin, lots of alpha helices, again, No, beta. Did you go and look at chymotrypsin? A lot more beta conformation than alpha helix. Yes, and if you add that up, it doesn't equal 100 because remember, there's going to be turns, there's going to be areas that are not, no set overall three-dimensional structure to them, more of linking sequences. When you read the textbook, you hear me lecture, you read primary literature, you're going to see that there's two words they like to bandy about: motif and domain. A motif is when you look at and you see some structure, overall pattern to the structure. This, what they refer to as a beta barrel. It's a motif. This, you follow this polypeptide, beta strand, alpha helix, beta strand, all of this, which will be set conserved throughout whatever this protein is and all the animals that use this protein, that's a motif. A domain, well, it's a collection of motifs in an overall large protein, but the thing is, this large protein you see here, I could cut it right there. This section right there still could have some abilities, still could have some functionality to it. Just like this half right there could still have some functionality to it, could still bind to, or could, if something interacts with it, could do an enzymatic catalytic thing with it. It's different than the domain because the domain, two beta strands and an alpha helix don't do anything. That beta barrel thing doesn't do anything on its own. Motif, domain, much larger picture, much larger portion of that overall polypeptide that once removed still has some ability to it. May not be the complete ability of what the protein had, but it still has some functionality, will still maintain its overall shape. You cut those motifs off without everything else there stabilizing. Yeah, that beta strand, alpha helix, beta strand, that'll unravel. Same with that beta barrel. Without everything else there stabilizing it, you cut that out of the overall protein itself, it will fall apart. It will unravel. And there are certain rules when it comes to folding in the tertiary level. Notice here all these beta strands back and forth, back and forth. This back and forth, back and forth, down to the next layer, back and forth, back and forth. That is what you will see. They refer to this, these sections, this beta motif where all these beta strands near each other. What you won't see is back and forth and then this jump over to another one, or this jump over where they're crossing over there. That leads to hard to do, because remember, these are going to be polypeptide or amino acid chains that are folding in on itself, may have some outside help, but not enough where they can get that crisscross thing going. That, yeah, not going to be good. And you'll see other things, this orientation of right-handed, the one on the right goes back and around it like that, or versus this left hand, this, yes, more often, this, rarely. And sometimes the beta strands, even though they're lining up near each other, they're not doing that up, down, map, folded map thing I talked about. Sometimes the beta strands, yes, individual strands may have that undulation thing going on, but they're twisting. That sheet, their form, could be twisted around, like we saw in the previous slide with those beta barrels. You take simple motifs, whether it's, hey, look, this beta alpha beta loop, beta barrel, or I'm sorry, beta strand, alpha helix, beta strand. And this could build up individual motif, get a collection of these motifs together, and you're now starting to see a domain or something that could hold its structure together and have some form of function, even if removed from the overall protein or whatnot. A lot of times when we're talking barrels, we are seeing beta strands, beta barrels, where they get those names. Well, you take this beta alpha beta loop, this motif, and you start linking them together, and you can do in such a way that these beta strands are all oriented together at the center of this overall protein. You now have that beta barrel. Remember I told you the beta barrel is a motif? You go through and you cut away all these alpha helices, that beta barrel falls apart. Hence its motif. And all comes right down to it. Some proteins just defy all our rules. Everything we've been talking about, the examples we've been using, they just don't fall into those categories. And that's what we call these intrinsically disordered. The intrinsically disordered, you know, no set structure. Okay. Up till now, you know, collagen is collagen. You know, that alpha fibrin, that's alpha fibrin's gonna, cytochrome C, it's always gonna look like cytochrome C. These intrinsically disordered, sometimes, no. They don't have a set shape. You can't look at the structure and, oh, here's all the alpha helices of that. Oh, that's a cytochrome C. No hydrophobic core, because remember the hydrophobic core is going to help globular proteins maintain a specific shape. Lysine, arginine, glutamate, highly charged residues here. And what we see is these proteins interact with multiple things. Up till now, the proteins we've been talking about, cytochrome C, trypsin, troponin, and all these, they interact with one and one thing only. Now we're going to see things that can play well with others. P53 is this protein right here. P53 is one of those that doesn't have a complete set shape, okay? Yes, there are alpha helices and beta strands and a beta barrel in it, but it's not held in to a strict tertiary quaternary structure. Because of that, the blue you see here, and here, and here, and here, these are all P53 and how it interacts with different substrates, cyclin A, citrulline, CVP binding domain, and whatever that one is, S100B. Defies the odds. Because hopefully you remember back in 244, or maybe Cell if you took it and put downstairs in biology, that enzymes have a distinct shape. Their active site is the correct shape for one and only one substrate, or anything mimicking the shape of that substrate. Here we have an enzyme, a protein, that can interact with, I mean, here's what's showing here, four things that there is no set, you know, or they do not look like, they do not mimic each other in any way, shape, or form. So you go and you look at that protein data bank, you know, 150,000 plus structures. And it's not just human proteins, it's all proteins they're going and looking at. You'll go through and you'll start to see the different structures. You know, you'll see, you know, ribbon models, space filling, and all this, all the data that's used to make these. But you go and you start looking at those, and you can take that data And you can start laying it out. There's now programs that'll take the information from that database and give you proposed secondary structure, give you proposed tertiary quaternary structures. Give you idea where certain motifs are. Maybe even tell you overall domains. Can either tell you that, or you can give you what you see here, known as a topology diagram. It lays everything out on a plane. You follow the line. You can start at the amino terminus, and you can end, oh, it's behind my big head here, with the carboxy terminus. And it follows along. Beta strand, which goes over to another motif of, interlocking beta strands, which goes through some different alpha helices, and just on and on and on. It's another way beyond a ribbon model, beyond a space filling, beyond, structural, drawing the structure of the amino acids and then trying to go beyond that. Just another way to lay out, for us to lay out the information and discern some pattern in everything going on. When we start looking at, we look at the amino acid, the DNA sequence, which gives us the primary structure, there's way too much going on there. I mean, even between us humans, our gene, which is going to be the blueprint on how to make a polypeptide, there's a lot of variability between us. And that kind of gets, smoothed out, thanks to the fact that most of the amino acids have multiple codons that can code for them. But there's still going to be some chain differences, slight differences between us humans when you look at our individual proteins. You go and you start looking and comparing us to gibbons or any of the great apes and going on to monkeys and so on. Those differences get larger and larger, bigger and bigger. There are still going to be some of those residues, some of those amino acids that are going to be set. Okay, this is what needs to be there structurally. This is what needs to be there. Go and think back to previous lecture in chapter 3, the sequence of amino acids and that figure that showed you, hey, look at this place, large letter, this is the amino acid that has to be there. Some of them had little short letters or, larger the letter, the more, yes, this has to be there. The shorter letters that will be stacked, any of these could be there. So we start to look and compare those across all of the different species that are related, even if it's distantly related evolutionarily. And we can see that there's what we call protein families, globular, filamentous, whatever. And then you start breaking up the globular ones. And you could start seeing that, yeah, there's quite a few proteins across animals, across plants, and all these that seem to be related. Remember that homolog, paralog, analog discussion at the end of chapter 3? Well, that's where this comes into play too. So we start looking at what we call protein families and protein superfamilies. Protein families and superfamilies are collections where we scientists like to group like with like. So you take all these proteins that have, a relative structure that's the same. Boom, family. Group all of these protein families together that have may not have exactly the same shape, but they have the same exact role. And you start to build and build. And as you bring in new organisms, this fits in this family into this superfamily. And we can use this to backtrack the evolution of certain metabolic processes. To have a metabolic process, you have to have a protein. No protein, no enzyme, no process. So we can start doing it like that. We can start when you talk quaternary structure. Touched on this before, and we're going to end this mini lecture with this. That quaternary structure is one or more polypeptides that have to come together to form the complete protein. The protein that has the correct conformation to have a, function for that cell. An individual peptide may be a protein, but not all proteins are individual peptides. Sometimes it has to take multiple subunits. The example right here is hemoglobin. Hemoglobin, four subunits, two alpha, two beta. Individual alpha, individual beta doesn't do anything. Two alphas, one beta, nada. Two betas, one alpha, nada. Two and two. Two and two come together, you have a complete protein. On the flip side, there's other proteins that are just one polypeptide. It's a really big, long polypeptide, and that's all that's needed for the correct structure to have the correct function.